Good morning. Welcome to Cornerstone. We are so glad to be here with you today. If you could please find your seats, it's time for the morning announcements. If this is your first time at Cornerstone, would you please meet us at the guest center in the lobby, located directly at the back doors of the auditorium? We'd love to have a chance to meet you and get to know you a little bit better. Thank you. Here at Cornerstone, we love God and we love others. And one of the ways we do that is through our giving. We have three ways that you can give: online using Church Center, you can mail it into the church, or you can give in a drop box in the back of the auditorium. Because you give, we can serve. Today is Mission Sunday, and just a quick reminder that the Thrive baby bottles are out at the Info Center out in the lobby. So make sure you grab yours before you go today. Cornerstone's giving statements have gone out. You will have received an email with a downloadable form for yours, or you can always check your Church Center app and find yours there as well. So make sure you get that, download it, so you have it for tax season. On January 23rd, we'll be having our second youth and young adults worship night here at Cornerstone. It was an amazing time the first time, so if you are a youth or a young adult, do not miss out on this. It is a great night. Be there. Students from 6th grade to 12th, Awakening is coming up the end of February. Early bird registration is due by February 4th. It is going to be an amazing time. Pastor Joey Silva is going to be speaking. Our own Pastor Abby and Joel are going to be leading worship. It is my favorite weekend of the year. It is so much fun. Make sure you're there. Make sure you get signed up. Check out Church Center for the sign up. Do not miss out on this amazing weekend. And that's it for your announcements. To stay up to date or for more information on what's going on here at Cornerstone, check out the Church Center app or check out the paper bulletins located out in the lobby. Thank you. Have an amazing day.
You are, Jesus.
Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. Take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing, Lord, all that you've done for me. Chaos back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. Done for me.
And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
Jesus, because you are great. There is none exalted like our God, like you, Lord Jesus. You are high and lifted up today. You are mighty in your temper. You are holy and righteous. You are worthy of all of our praise today, God. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. There is none like you. There is none like our God. We praise you, Jesus.
He is so good. This next song that we're going to sing, it talks a lot about who God is. It talks about God being a way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. And this morning, I want us to really know that that is who He is. A lot of times it can be hard to worship someone or to worship something that you don't know. It can be hard to love someone that you don't know. And this morning, I want you to know that the Lord is all of those things for you. That He's been all of those things all throughout Scripture, not just for you, but for the church, for His people. He has always been faithful. He is a promise keeper. So let's sing this out this morning.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. Yes, you are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are.
Come on, sing it out.
You are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. Healing every heart.
Yes, Lord.
I worship you. I worship you.
I worship you.
You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. And even when I don't see it, you're working. And even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. Come on, guys. Even when I don't see it, you're working. And even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. And even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Oh, that is who you are. 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 On those things. I know that life is tough, but we're all here. The Lord has made a way. The Lord has kept his promises, and we are here today. And so today, as we continue to sing the song, as we continue to worship, I want you to think about that. I want you to think about the promises that the Lord has given you and that he has kept. I want you to think about the promises that the Lord has given to you, and maybe you haven't seen the answer yet. But he is a promise-keeping God. He is a way maker. He will always make a way. He made a way back then. He led the Israelites through the sea. He was with them in the furnace. And he's going to be with you. He always is. So let's think. Let's just think on those things. Let's think on those promises, on the past that he's making for us. Father God, we thank you that you are a promise-keeping God, that you are faithful, Lord. And there is no evidence contrary to that, Lord. But you have always been faithful. You have always been good. You are a great God. You are so powerful, and none can stand against you. And Lord, I am just so thankful, God, that you keep your promises to us, even when we don't deserve it, God. Lord, you are good. Lord, you have kept every single promise. Every promise to your people before us, God, and you've kept every promise to us individually. And Lord, I pray that you would strengthen our faith, that you would build us up, Lord, that we would know that you are a promise-keeping God, that we would know that you are faithful, that we would know these things about you, God, that we would worship you fully for who you are, Lord. Maybe we don't see it, God, but we know that you're working and that you're moving, God. Lord, you are a promise keeper, and we will not forget that, Lord. We will remember your goodness and your faithfulness, Lord. We will remember your promises, those that have come to pass, Lord, and those that we're still waiting in. And God, we praise you for that, Lord. We will not forget, God. We remember Jesus. That is who you are. 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 You never stop, you never stop working. And even when I don't see it, you're working. And even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, and even when I don't see it, you're working. And even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop. Jesus, that you are faithful. Lord, that you have loved us so, so well. And Lord, we just thank you that, Jesus, even when you ascended into heaven, Lord, that you told us that we would have an advocate, that you would send your Spirit, God. And I just pray that in this service this morning, that we would be sensitive to your Holy Spirit, God, that we would be open to you moving. And Lord, that we wouldn't place up our own barriers, our own obstacles, but God, we would be fully present in this moment, and that your Spirit would break out all over this place, God. Lord, we love you and we want to be with you. We want your presence, God. Lord, we thank you that you've given that to us. Thank you, Jesus. We will worship you, Lord. Amen.
Our Father, all of heaven roars your name. Sing louder. Let this place erupt with praise. Can you hear it? The sound of heaven touching earth. The sound of heaven touching earth. Our Father, all of heaven roars your name. Sing louder. Let this place erupt with praise. Can you hear? The sound of heaven touching earth. The sound of heaven touching earth. Spirit, break out. Break our walls down. Spirit, break out. Heaven come down. Spirit break out. Break our walls down. Spirit break out. And heaven come down.
Spirit, we invite your presence into this place, not just in a room, but in our hearts.
We recognize that we need you as we go through this life. We recognize we can't do this on our own. We need your presence with us to empower us and give us clarity and the wisdom and the boldness that we need to face the circumstances that we come against. And so, Father, I pray for each person that's here and has a need or has a worry or a concern. I pray that your spirit would break out in their life, that you would bring healing where it's needed, that you would bring wisdom where it's needed, that you would give clarity, answers. God, I pray that you would be the God that's not far off, but that's close, that dwells in and among us. God, I pray that as we call out to you today, that you would change us and through us change our circumstances. We put our trust in you today and we recognize our need for you. And so Jesus, as we've taken this time to sing praise and to worship and to lift up your name, now we want to make sure that we are lifting up your word. I pray in a moment as we open up your word and as we look at what it is that you have to say to us, I pray that you would speak to our hearts and that you would challenge us and you would change us and you would convict us where we need it. We want to be changed by your word. We want to be more like you. So help us, we pray. We call out to you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. You can take a seat. Thanks for being here today. I want to thank Pastor Abby and our worship team for leading us in worship. I want to welcome each of you here today. Thanks for being here. I'm going to have the part of the band continue to play a little bit because there are certain moments in the life of a church where we just kind of pause and we get to do some really neat family stuff. And today is one of those days. Today we're going to be dedicating a couple of children to the Lord. We here at church recognize that in Psalm 127 verse 3, it says that children are a gift from God. So we recognize here at Cornerstone that our kids are not our own, but we have a responsibility to raise them and to steward that responsibility and raise them up in the way of God. And so one of the things that we do here at Cornerstone from time to time is we dedicate children to the Lord. Our practice is not to baptize children. Our theology on that would be that at a point where the child understands and determines that they want to follow Jesus, that's when they will go and be baptized. But dedication is different. Dedication is not salvation. I want to be very clear on that. We don't believe that in the moment here when we bring these children up and the family and we pray that these children are saved at this point and they become Christians. It's just simply the direction of the parents' hearts and of our church that we are going to do our best to help these children understand and know who God is and at some point make a decision to follow after him. So, you know, with COVID the last couple of years, we've had a little bit of delay, I think, in some of our kids getting dedicated. So in a couple of weeks, we're going to do another dedication. But today we have the Weisman family. You probably know this family. Pastor Jake is our youth pastor here, and they're going to come on up. Yeah, you guys can. If there's any other, I don't know if you got family in town or nope. Okay. They're going to come on up, and we're going to dedicate Griffin, and we're going to dedicate Hallie today, and we're going to take some time to, man, looking good. Look at this dude right here. Come on. Come on around. Come on, everybody. Come on. Can you strike a pose, Griff? Can you show? Dude, look at how nice this guy looks. Isn't that awesome? Well, dedication of a child is an important Hi. Hi. Good to see you. I don't know. We're going to try. I don't know if she's going to come to me, so we'll see. But dedication of a child is a moment where these parents have said, it's our intention to raise our kids in the way of the Lord. I always share from Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 through 7. It says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road and when you lie down and when you get up." In other words, and I know you know this, but in other words, your faith needs to be more than something that's personalized in your heart that you never talk about. It needs to be something more than is just expressed here at church. It needs to be something that is in your home. It needs to be lived out. And by dedicating your children here today, you're making that statement, right? That you're going to raise your kids in the way of the Lord. You know, I often say, refer to that a little proverb that it takes a village to raise a child. I like to say it takes a church to raise children. And so as much as this is a moment for this family to come up here and say, we want our children to know God, and would you pray with us, and would you encourage us along the way? What they're doing is they're inviting us, the church family, into the process. It's not just this family. It's this family that has the responsibility of raising these kids. And so I want to charge you, church, to do the same. If you spend any time in this room after second service, you know that if you stand in one of these aisles, chances are one of these kids or another child is going to run you over. They come in here and they just run laps in here. And it's beautiful. I love it. That's one of my favorite parts of our church, all the kids just running around. But you're going to have moments where you're going to interact with these children in one way or another. You might be a Sunday school teacher. It might be them running past you after a service. It might just be that you hear of a need that you're going to pray for. But church, we also have a responsibility to this family. So this is what I'd like for us to do. We're going to take a moment here, and we're going to pray for this family and for these kids. But I want to ask you to be a part of this as well. So if you would you stand with me? One of the things that we do, we're going to pray for this family as a body and as a church family together. If you feel comfortable, one of the expressions that we have, because not everybody can gather around and clump up here, we just, as an expression, reach out our hands as a symbol that we're praying for this family. So I'm going to try to take Hallie and see if she'll come to me. Hey, Hallie. Hi. Hi, how are you? Daddy's right there. I'm going to face right there. Oh no. Oh, okay, we're good. You want to say hi? Say hi to them. Hi. Okay, she's staring at me. I think we're good. We're going to say a word of prayer. Would you pray with me as we pray for this family? God, we are so grateful for the Weismans. God, we're so grateful for Pastor Jake and his ministry among us and the work that he's doing with our teens. God, he has a great responsibility here at the church, but he has an even greater responsibility in his own home with these children. And so, Father, we pray for your blessing to be upon this family. Jesus, I pray that as they talk about you and your love for them and their love for you in their home, God, I pray that it would instill a great love for Jesus in these children. Lord, we lift up Griff to you. And we lift up Hallie to you, and we lift up Evie as well. And we pray, God, your blessing on these children. Jesus, may they know you and may they walk in your ways. And God, I pray that you would be with our church family, that we would be a support to them, that we truly would be a family, that we would love and come alongside and support them in the ways that they need. So bless this family. We dedicate these children to you. May they know you. May they walk in your ways. May they be blessed by you. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hey, we made it. We made it. All right, go back to Dad. I know. I'm so sorry, but you're adorable. Hey, can you thank them and welcome them and bless them with a clapping? God bless you guys. You can take a seat. Thanks so much for being here, and thanks for playing, Morgan. Appreciate that as well. Love getting a chance to hold babies, even if they cry. I'm not going to hold it against you, Hallie. So anyway, God bless you. It's great to see each of you here today. Today is the third Sunday of the month, and that means that today is Missions Sunday. But today is also another day. It is Sanctity of Human Life Sunday as well. And on Sanctity of Human Life Sunday, it's a day where we recognize the importance of life. And it's a time where we can recommit to protecting human life at every stage. So what we're going to do today is we're going to kind of combine Mission Sunday with Sanctity of Human Life Sunday. And we want to support a ministry that's a local ministry right here in our own backyard that values life. Now, if you've been a part of our church for a while, you know that typically we highlight the ministry of Thrive in May. But over the last couple of years, we've just decided that, Sanctity of Human Life Sunday is in January. So why do that in May? So we've kind of switched it around. And today, what we have in the back, some of you may have seen those little bins in the back. Those are filled with baby bottles. And the idea is, I said this first service, they've been doing this baby bottle thing for a long time. And the idea is you put your change in there throughout the course of the month, and then you bring it back in 4 weeks. And then we take those bottles and we just give them to Thrive, and those donations go directly to their organization. But here's the thing. I think now in like COVID, post-COVID stuff, like I think most people don't probably have change or cash just that they're using. A lot of people, use credit cards or electronic or whatever, and that's fine too. So if you don't want to write out a check and put one in there, you can certainly use the Church Center app and you can give online. Just make sure if you do, you use the mission guest, even though there's not a guest here today, use mission guest, and everything that comes in this month for missions guest is going to be sent directly on to Thrive. But if you like the idea of having the baby bottle as a place to remember and pray, Thrive is a crisis pregnancy center that helps people that find themselves in situations, and they advocate for life, and it's an incredible organization. We've been partnering with them for well over a decade. I don't even know however many years we've been partnering with them. So I want to make sure that you're aware of that. So grab one of those on the way out. Well, today we are in a series of messages called Clash of Kingdoms. And if you're new to Cornerstone, again, welcome. My name is Eric. I'm the pastor here. But if you're new to our church, you may not be aware of this, but what we do as a church is, over the last couple of years, we've been making our way through the Gospel of Matthew, verse by verse, section by section, and today we find ourselves in Matthew chapter 21, verses 33 through 46. Now, this passage of scripture that we're looking at here is really like the beginning of the last week of Jesus's life before he went to the cross. And as we've been looking at Matthew chapter 21 up to this point, we see that there has been a clash of kingdoms, the clash of the kingdom of heaven that Jesus has been announcing and preaching and teaching about, and the clash of the religious leaders. Jesus has been in conflict and in tension with the religious leaders. And last week, in the section before this, we saw Jesus telling a parable that was condemning of the religious leaders. He's in the temple, and he's continuing on now. He's going to tell two more parables, but we're going to look at the second parable here today. And I should just say this before we get into the parable. A parable is a simple story. It's a short, kind of fictitious story, and these were stories that Jesus told that explained the truths of the kingdom. So there's symbolism in it, there's imagery in these, they're kind of poetic in some ways, but Jesus has told this first parable, indicting the religious leaders, and now he's jumping into the second one here in verse 33. He says this, "Listen to another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, and he put a wall around it. He dug a wine press in it, and he built a watchtower. Then he rented the vineyard to some farmers, and he moved to another place." Now, it's easy for us just to kind of read over this, but I want to stop, and I want you to catch the different steps that are going on here with this landowner. He's very involved in the process of taking this land that presumably was unkept, and now he's developing it into a vineyard. He plants it, he puts up a wall, he takes time to dig out a wine press, and he even builds a watchtower so someone can keep an eye on the land from predators. So the landowner here is making a significant investment of time and money and energy in order to make something that will be productive and fruitful. But there's something more going on here. Now, if I were to say to you, hey, I'm going to tell you a story, and it starts like this. A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away, okay? Now, if I say that to you, what am I talking about? Just, yes, Star Wars. Yeah, some of you are like really excited to say that. You're like jumping, you're ready to say that. Yes, Star Wars. Now, how do you know that just by the opening line or just by some text on a screen? Well, it's obvious. I mean, this is a major part of our culture. This is a major movie franchise. I don't know if everybody's watched the movies, but we're all at least aware of Star Wars and that phrase. Now, whether you're a fan of Star Wars or not, when you hear those words or when you see this image on the screen, you immediately identify with the reference. And so when Jesus is talking about a vineyard, he says, hey, I'm going to tell you a parable. I'm going to tell you a parable about a vineyard. Immediately, the people in the audience would have got the reference. They know that in the Old Testament, all throughout, the vineyard, when it's mentioned, is often referring to God's people, Israel. They would have, I know what he's talking about. He's using the reference that the vineyard represents God's people. But there's a particular, it's not just generally speaking about all these passages, there's a very specific passage, in fact, that Jesus is referring to at the beginning of this parable. And it comes from one of the prophets of Israel, and it's the prophet Isaiah. In chapter 5, Isaiah sings this song, or he writes this poem about God being an owner of a piece of land and creating creating a vineyard. And I want you to see the parallels and the connections between what Isaiah was writing. It says this in verse 1. I will sing for the one I love, God. I will sing for the one I love a song about his vineyard. My loved one had a vineyard on a fertile hillside. Verse 2. Look at what he does here. He dug it up. He cleared it of stones and planted it with the choicest vines. He built a watchtower in it and cut out a wine press as well. Now, I think you can probably see the similarities here as to what's going on. Jesus's parable talks about a landowner working to create a vineyard, and there's specific steps. And here, it's almost the same language that Isaiah used. So again, if I say to you, a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away, you know what kind of story I'm telling. You know that that's going to be a science fiction story with aliens and spaceships and lightsabers and all that kind of stuff. And in a very similar way, when Jesus mentions vineyard and the owner going through steps like this, they understand what kind of story Jesus is going to tell in this parable, because they're familiar with the pop culture of their day, if you will, with Isaiah the prophet and the words that he spoke to Israel hundreds of years before this in Isaiah chapter 5. And so the question is, if Jesus' hearers knew the context of that, the question is, do you? Do I? Do we know what Isaiah 5 is about? Well, if you don't, it's okay. I'm going to read for you the next several verses of this little poem or song that Isaiah the prophet was writing about, so we can be up to speed. So when we get back to Jesus' parable, we know the context of what was going on here. It says this. So this vineyard is created and it's planted and it's ready, and it says this. Then he looked for a crop of good grapes, but it yielded only bad fruit. And then now there's a quotation here. This is God speaking. Now you dwellers in Jerusalem and people of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more could have been done for my vineyard than I have done for it? God is saying, look, I did all the things you're supposed to do for a vineyard. I cultivated it. I worked on it. I built the wall up. I did all those things. When I looked for good grapes, then why did it only yield bad grapes? Now I will tell you what I'm going to do to my vineyard. I will take away its hedge, and it will be destroyed. I will break down its wall, and it will be trampled. I will make it a wasteland, neither pruned nor cultivated, and briars and thorns will grow there. I will command the clouds not to rain on it. Now there's like an end quote there, and now there's an explanation of what's going on here. Verse 7, the vineyard of the Lord Almighty is the nation of Israel, and the people of Judah are the vines he delighted in. And he looked for justice, but saw bloodshed. He looked for righteousness, but he heard cries of distress. So this is a prophecy. This poem that Isaiah is singing, or the song that he's singing, is a prophecy of God's judgment against his people. The landowner is God. The vineyard represents Israel. And God gave his people every opportunity to obey, to produce good fruit, but they didn't. And so he determines that he's going to bring judgment on them because he looked for fruit and he couldn't find it. What was the fruit that he was looking for? He was looking for justice and righteousness. But instead, what did he find? He found bloodshed and cries of distress. Now, I want to point out something that Isaiah is doing here in this poem that he's writing about God. He's making a play on words here, and he's using similar sounding words to make a point here. So the word for justice is the Hebrew word mishpat, and the word for bloodshed is mispach, and you have to kind of at the end. It's not great for COVID season, but at the same time, it's how you say it, okay? It's mispach. And then he says the word for righteousness is tzedakah, and the cries of distress is tzeakah. There's no duh sound in the middle. So in other words, what God is saying through Isaiah is this. I looked for mishpat, but found mispach. I looked for tzedakah, but instead I found tzeakah. Now, this is some brilliant writing here. This is like the guys that wrote the Old Testament, these ancient writers, were not just knuckleheads just kind of scribbling down on a tablet or something. They were absolute geniuses and artists in the way that they put the text together. And this kind of play on words is very common in Jewish literature. There's a scholar named Tim Mackey in talking about this verse here and the language here. He says this. He says, the distance between a community of people living in tzedakah and mishpat is just one letter different from becoming a community of mishpach and tzedakah. There's a fine line between the two. And see, this song or this poem that Isaiah is communicating is talking about that fine line. God says, I'm looking for this, and you're one letter off, but it's a drastic difference than what I'm looking for. And because of that, judgment is coming. Now, this is the context of what Jesus is communicating in this parable to the religious leaders. Now, remember, he's been going toe-to-toe with them as it is, and now he's coming in again to speak against these religious leaders. And so what Jesus is going to do now is he's not going to quote exactly from Isaiah, because otherwise he'd just quote Isaiah. What he's doing is going to riff off of that and make it appropriate for the context and the people that he's talking to, the religious leaders. And so he continues his parable back in Matthew chapter 1 in the second part of verse 33. So then the landowner rented the vineyard to some farmers, and he moved to another place. So in Isaiah's song, the landowner immediately looks for fruit. But here, instead, what he does is he rents the vineyard to some farmers, and he moves to another place. Now, that was appropriate context for what was happening in that area in the first century. There were many absentee landlords. The Jewish people in particular were crushed under the weight of debt, and so oftentimes they had to sell their ancestral lands that all of their generations before them had lived on. They'd have to sell them off to these absentee landlords, and then sometimes they actually had to work their own land and take the fruit that should be theirs and give a good portion of it to these landowners. So there was sometimes some tension and conflict there. Verse 34, when the harvest time approached, the landowner sent his servants to the tenants to collect his fruit. So a vineyard would take about 4 years in order to yield a profit. And we're not told if this is the first year for the harvest or the fourth year or the 10th year, but there's been some sort of a business arrangement that was made. Hey, you come work the land, you get this amount, I get that amount. And so he's coming to collect, but instead of collecting, look at what happens here in the next two verses. The tenants seized his servants. They beat one, killed another, and stoned a third. Then he sent other servants to them, more than the first, and the tenants treated them the same way. Okay, so this parable now is taking a drastic turn. It's a shocking and it's completely unexpected behavior from these tenants. And it's not really clear yet what's causing them to have this reaction. Now, when it comes to parables like this, it's important for us to recognize that the purpose of parables isn't to answer all the questions. It's not to give us all the details. The purpose of a parable is to cause us to stop and think and kind of mull over what's being communicated here. And so the question right here in the story so far is this: why on earth are the tenants acting this way? Why are they so vicious? You know, many ancient landowners were known for their harsh treatment of their tenants. But here it's reversed. In fact, the landowner is shown to be someone that has had care and investment and creativity and time and energy into the field. He's the one that put all this together. And these tenants are the ones that are cruel and lashing out against him. So what's causing this? Well, obviously, at the very least, these tenants don't respect the landowner. But as we'll see, it's more that they appear to think that they have claims to this prophecy or to this property. They think that they should own this for themselves, and they're going to go to extreme measures to make sure it happens. The next several verses explain that. It says this: last of all, after sending all these servants, last of all, he sent his son to them. They'll respect my son, he said. But when the tenants saw the son, they said to each other, this is the heir. Come. Let's kill him and take his inheritance. And so they took him and they threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. So we as modern readers are reading back. We know about the events that took place about a week later to Jesus, how he was crucified out of the city, how the Son of God was killed and placed on a cross. So we see that here and we know that. We understand that the Son in the story represents Jesus. Now, for months leading up to this, Jesus has been telling his disciples that he was going to die at the hands of the religious leaders. He says, look, we're going to get to Jerusalem, and when we get in there, there's going to be conflict, and they're going to take my life. But now, he's essentially telling the religious leaders themselves what they're going to do to him in a veiled way in the form of this parable. Now, everything in this parable is excessive and extreme. Even the details of the landowner's development of the land, or his patience with the tenants, and the violence that's being perpetrated against his servants and now his son. The whole story has really turned very quickly after that first section, and it's very shocking and unexpected. But Jesus doesn't bring the parable to a conclusion. He doesn't give the answer at the end. Instead, he asks a question to those who he's speaking to, the religious leaders. He says this, "Therefore, when the owner of the vineyard comes, after they've killed his servants, after they killed his son, when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants?" And the religious leaders respond in verse 41. "He will bring those wretches to a wretched end," they replied. "And he will rent the vineyard to other tenants who will give him his share of the crop at harvest time." I mean, the injustice here is obvious, and the religious leaders see it, and they can't help but condemn this obvious wickedness of these tenants. But by saying this, they're actually pronouncing their own sentence. And Jesus drives this point home in the next verse, but he does this by introducing another image for us. Verse 42. Jesus said to them, and I love how he said, what he says here. He says, "Have you never read the scriptures?" Now, today, we're blessed with phones that have apps on them. You can download a Bible app. You can get on Amazon and order a Bible. It'll be there in 2 days or less. You can go to a bookstore. You can go to a hotel and find Bibles often in the nightstands there. Bibles are very readily available to us here today. But in the first century, they weren't. They were expensive. They were on scrolls. And they were basically held by the religious leaders. And so Jesus is kind of ribbing these guys like, "Come on, you guys have the scriptures. Haven't you read this? Don't you know what it says?" It says, "The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone, and the Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes." Now, this kind of comes out of the blue, to be honest. If we're paying attention to what's happened in the text before this, and even here in the parable, we've been talking about a vineyard, and we've been talking about fruit, but now we got stones and buildings. It doesn't seem like it really makes sense. Is Jesus just kind of like, just pulling that out of nowhere? No, Jesus knows exactly what he's doing for a couple reasons. First, let's remember where Jesus is. He's teaching in the temple, and right there in the temple were these massive stones that were cut to order that were cornerstones of the temple. And it's very possible that as Jesus is saying this here, that he's pointing to one of the stones as an illustration. But if you look closely at the text there on the screen or in your Bible, you'll notice that there are quotation marks around this as well. And that's because Jesus, again, is making a connection to the Old Testament. I like to use the word hyperlink. You know, he's hyperlinking over to the Old Testament to a passage from Psalm 118. Now, we've talked about Psalm 118 before in chapter 21. It was mentioned in verse 9. If you remember when Jesus is coming into the city of Jerusalem, he's riding on the donkey, and the people are calling out, one of the things that they said was a quotation from Psalm 118. And they said, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." So that's part of the psalm that Jesus is quoting here. And he's quoting this part. It's kind of, the idea is like a builder who was commissioned to build a building. So he goes to a rock quarry and he says, "Look, I need stones like this. I need stones cut like that. And I need some that are like this." And in the process of the stonemasons cutting those stones, one of them, for whatever reason, seemed to be wrong, incorrect. And so it was set aside as rejected and not really important. But in fact, that stone ended up being the most important stone of all. And so Jesus is making this point. He said, "Look, there was a rejection of this stone here, but it actually was the most important." Now, that's all great, but you still might be saying, "Pastor Eric, why on earth are we talking about stones and buildings and when we've been talking about vineyards and fruit?" It's because Jesus knows exactly what he's doing. He is making another wordplay here. Remember, Jesus has framed this parable in the language of Isaiah 5. And here, Jesus is making another wordplay. The word for son is ben. And so we talked about this son in this parable. But the word for stone is eben. Eben. So Jesus has been telling a story about a rejected ben. And now he's quoting a psalm about a rejected eben. I mean, do you see the layers here to what Jesus is doing? He's not only using the language of, if you will, Star Wars, or the thing that they would understand, to let them know he's talking about judgment, but he's also using a wordplay in his parable when he was referencing in Isaiah that there was a wordplay as well. I mean, come on, this is pretty, like, as a Bible person, like, this makes me, like, really excited. Like, I love this. It's like Bible nerd stuff, okay? This is awesome. And Jesus is communicating this message to these religious leaders, and he's saying to them, look, like you're the tenants. We need to kind of get our bearings here. Jesus has been speaking out against the religious leaders. He's telling this parable about a vineyard. He's using the language of Isaiah 5. There's this prophecy of judgment against God's people and the wordplay. And so this parable is a statement that Jesus is making about the religious leaders. They were like the tenants that rejected God's servants. Who were his servants? The prophets over the years. And there's a built-in expectation. There's tension, I think, as Jesus is communicating this. They're waiting for the judgment statement to come. It hasn't come quite yet, because he gives this statement about Psalm 118 and the rejected son and now the rejected stone. In the parable, the son is killed. But in this quotation of Psalm 118, there's a reversal and the stone is exalted. Now, Jesus doesn't say this. He kind of leaves it unsaid. But the implication is, just like the stone was rejected, but actually was most important, the implication is, in the story, the son was rejected, but the son, something will happen to him as well. It's left unsaid there on purpose. There's a tension in there. So where's the judgment? Well, it comes in the next couple of verses here, verse 43. He says, therefore, I tell you, he's talking to the religious leaders, I tell you that the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people who will produce its fruit. Now, again, if you've been with us the last couple of weeks and messages in this series, you know that fruit is one of the main ideas of chapter 21. Certainly a section or two in, fruit is the main driving idea, that God is concerned with the fruit of our lives. And this is what motivated Jesus when he prophetically entered the temple on the day before this, and he condemned it. This is why Jesus cursed the fig tree. The morning before he's telling these parables. And this is what the previous parable was about. If you remember, the previous parable was about two sons. One son, the father said, hey, I want you to do this. And the son said, yes, I will, but then didn't. And then the other son said, no, I won't, but then he did. One produced fruit and the other one didn't. And so the warning all throughout, and even in this parable here, is that bad fruit results in judgment. The religious leaders were like the wicked tenants who wanted to own something that wasn't theirs. They didn't want to produce fruit for the master, but they wanted it for themselves. So Jesus says, the kingdom's going to be taken from you, and it's going to be given to someone else who will produce fruit. So who is that? Well, it's a transfer from the fruitless religious establishment of the religious leaders and the temple to the fruitful community of those who put their faith in Jesus. The judgment continues in verse 4. He says, and anyone who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, and anyone on whom it falls will be crushed. This whole section here is really dense with references to other places. And right here, even in this verse, we're not going to take time to get into it, but there's two other references right here. If you want to do a little bit more exploring, you can get on the Church Center app and look at the sermon notes. I've got tons of stuff in there that you can look at. But here, there are two more references. The falling on the rock refers to Isaiah chapter 8, and then being crushed by the rock refers to Daniel chapter 2. So Jesus is like hyperlinking all these things as he's talking. So Jesus essentially is ending this parable with a severe warning. He's saying, look, rejecting the Ben, rejecting the Son that God has sent is going to result in judgment. And the judgment is either going to fall on you or you are going to fall on it. And none of this is really lost on the religious leaders. Verses 45 and 46. When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard Jesus' parables, they knew he was talking about them. So they looked for a way to arrest him, but they were afraid of the crowd because the people held that he was a prophet. Now, there's a little bit of irony here in Matthew's telling of this, because by reacting in this way, the religious leaders are creating the very situation that they've been warned about. Their desire to arrest Jesus is revealing their desire to reject and kill the Son. But they don't enact their plans yet. They pause because they're afraid of causing a riot, and then Rome gets involved, and that's bad news for everybody. So a lot of stuff going on here, a lot of layers in this text. What do we do with this? Where do we go from here? I've got a few thoughts that I want to leave us with today. And the first is this. The first is God is patient. God is patient. I mean, consider the care and the time and the attention and the detail that he put into this vineyard. He invested a great deal of energy and finances into getting the vineyard even up and running in the first place. But that's his patience in that is even dwarfed by his patience with the tenants, isn't it? He sends servant after servant, even more servants, and they're abused and killed. And he even goes so far as to bring his son to them. Now look, if you're far from God today, I just want to encourage you and give you some hope today and remind you that God is patient and he is loving. And he is giving you time to accept the Ben, to accept his son. He's giving you time to produce the fruit of faith. He's patient with you. So just as true as it is that God is patient, here's another thing we can pull from this. It's this: God will judge. He's patient. I love how in Isaiah, God speaks and he says, "What more could I have been done?" He's reasoning it out. He says, "Look, you see my vineyard. What more could I have done?" God is given ample opportunity to his people, and he's giving ample opportunity to you as well. And the fruit that he's looking for isn't perfection. He's looking for the fruit of faith. He's looking for the one who will accept his son. Now, what it comes down to, I think, is the question that we asked in the middle of the parable. This is what stands out for me the most as I read this. It's like, why did the tenants act the way that they did? I mean, what caused them? I mean, there was a business arrangement. They knew all of this. Somehow, somewhere along the line, these tenants forgot that they were tenants. They forgot that they were stewards of the land, and they begin to believe that they deserve to be owners of the land. They thought, well, I'm doing all this work. Why should I give the fruit to that person? And instead, they said, no, I want control of the vineyard. And if we're honest, church, isn't that what happens to many of us as well? We have been given this incredible gift of life. And what do? We want to make it about us. And if we're not careful, what ends up happening is we ignore the care and the design of the Creator, the one who laid out the vineyard, the one who had an order and a design and a purpose for our lives. And instead of recognizing that, what do? We lay claim to our lives. We want to live the way we want to live. We want to produce the kind of fruit that we want to produce. We demand our rights. We live for ourselves. This is my life. I get to make the choices. And in doing so, what we end up doing is we end up rejecting the Son. And I think, church, we need to ask ourselves if we're like the tenants in this parable. Who owns your life? You know, again, I said this last week, and I'm going to say it again, and it's pertinent for us in the next section with the next parable too. But who is Jesus talking to? It's easy for us to look at something like this and just kind of assume that this is about bad people or sinners or people who are far from God. But Jesus is speaking to the people who had the scriptures. He's speaking to the religious leaders, and he has a warning for them. You need to accept the Ben, and you need to produce the fruit. I'm giving you every opportunity. And I think if Jesus were here today, he might say, church, I'm giving you every opportunity to produce the fruit of the kingdom. And so are you? Are you? Who owns your life? Who owns your life? Now, we are stewards, church. We're not owners. This life is a gift, and it's on loan to us. And you know, I thought I would put a wordplay up of my own. Isaiah has a wordplay, and Jesus has a wordplay. I don't know that this quite meets their standard, but we can ask ourselves this question. Does God owe me, or does he own me? Does God owe me, or does God own me? Because there's two different ways to walk through life, isn't there? And we can talk about all the sinners and people that live that way. God, you owe me. I get to do whatever I want. We can talk about that. But church, we do this too. I went to church today. You owe me, God. God, I did that. I was good to that person. You owe me, God. And oh my goodness, when we do that, we end up just like these landowners or the tenants of the land. We end up like these people who think that we've got some sort of right to ourselves. But our responsibility is to be just like the Son who came and gave his life for us. And now we recognize that our life is not our own. We were bought with a price. And so now we are called to honor our God, honor our God with our lives and the way we conduct ourselves. So, does God own me? Owe me, or does God own me? Are we living for him, or are we living for ourselves? That's the question, church, we need to ask today. Let's take a moment and pray. Jesus, we put our trust in you. I pray, Father, that you would, as I said at the beginning, that you would challenge us and you would change us and you would convict us where we need it. And to be quite honest, some of us are far from you today, and we need to be challenged and convicted that we have been living our own life in our own way, rebelling against you, sinning. And I pray for those who are far from you, that I pray that they would recognize the scriptures say that if we believe in our heart and confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord, that he is the Son, the chosen Son, that we will be saved. So God, I pray for those who are far from you today, that they would call out to you and put their trust in Jesus and accept the Son. But Lord, I also pray for believers in the room here today, because I know my heart. I've been in church long enough to know the hearts of a lot of other church people. I know that so often we get this mentality where we feel like God owes us something because of the good works we do or the way we live our life. But God, help us to remember too that you don't owe us anything. You own us. And we are your servants. We are your tenants in your vineyard. God, you've blessed us with this life. And we recognize today, we're reminded today that any time we try to take ownership of the land, we produce bloodshed and cries of despair and hurt and sorrow. But instead, Jesus, we want to reveal the fruit of the kingdom, justice and righteousness. Help us, we pray, to honor you, we ask. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to ask you to stand with me. This kind of a message is kind of heavy for us. And I think one of the appropriate responses is maybe you need to take some time and just pray and repent and say, oh God, I'm so sorry that I've been trying to be the owner of my life. I want to give myself to you. I'm going to take some time and I'm going to pray about that. I'm going to kneel down here at these stairs. I'm going to encourage you to come forward and find a place to pray. Make an altar and where you just sacrifice and say, it's not my life, it's yours. Romans says to offer yourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. That's symbolic of what we're doing here when we come and we kneel down and we say, oh, I want to be a living sacrifice. I don't own my life. You own me, Jesus. Do with me what you will. So I want to encourage you to come forward and pray. But maybe you have a need. I'm going to ask our prayer team to come forward as well. If you need to be prayed for, these people are here to pray with you. They'll keep your request private if you would like. Just let them know. But otherwise, let's stand, let's worship, let's express our love for our God, and let's really ask ourselves that question about who owns us. Does God owe us, or does God own us? Let's spend some time in reflection. Worship team, would you lead us?
Our Father, all of heaven roars your name. Sing louder. Let this place erupt with praise. Can you hear it? The sound of heaven touching earth. The sound of heaven touching earth. Our Father, all of heaven roars your name. Sing louder. Let this place erupt with praise. Can you hear it? The sound of heaven touching earth. The sound of heaven touching earth. Spirit, break out. Break our walls down. Spirit, break out. Heaven, come down. Spirit, break out. Break our walls down. Yeah.
Addiction. If you want to stay in worship or pray, you're more than welcome to do that. I know we've got some folks that are still praying. I don't want to stop that. But I want to encourage you this week. May you walk in the knowledge and the understanding that you are owned by God. And when you produce the fruit of the kingdom, you find your sweet spot in your calling and your purpose and your meaning in life. And so this week, may you throw off all of those ways where you've tried to take control of your life. And may you offer yourself to the King. And may you accept the Son. And in so doing, experience the fruit of the kingdom. The fruit that provides justice and righteousness to the people and the circumstances that you face. And so may the Lord bless you and keep you. May He make His face to shine upon you and give you peace. Man, God bless you. Have a great rest of the day. If you want to hang out and pray and worship, please do that. Otherwise, God bless. We'll see you on Wednesday for our prayer and worship time. Take care.